Hi guys, we're gonna go ahead and kick off. If you've been here before, we have Ash, so it's awesome to have Ash here. He's the original organizer of this meetup group. He also wrote a phenomenal book called Running Lean. It's kind of like, it's gonna be weird for me to be talking about experiments and sort of teaching you guys it. Having the person who's literally sits on my shoulder. I got to work with Ash for about 3 years, and almost in every decision I do in my business, I always have him on one side and then Seth Godin on the other. So those are sort of like the two little people that I have telling me to question my hypothesis or do permission marketing. Normally we meet up on the second Tuesday, and normally we do the big meetup group, but lately I've been wanting really to get more hands-on and go from just having people talking about these and really getting into the details of what happens when you try to put these principles to practice, and just some of the lessons that I've gone through firsthand and some of the things that Brennan has done as well. So why don't you tell a little bit about your background, and then...
Cool. So I just realized if I stand over there, I'm going to completely block that TV from everyone. So move ahead of that. Kind of title of workshop Emiliano convinced me to do with him is Lean Applied to Assumptions and Experiment Power Course. Hi, I'm Brendan. I'm a director of product optimization at an agency in Austin called Clearhead. So we're a validation and optimization agency. So we work with large brands online in order to test out their business ideas, see if they're any good. So we work with brands like Whole Foods, Adidas, New Balance, Cost Plus World Market. And my job as kind of a director of product optimization is to align with their business goals. So talk to their team, look at their product roadmap, look at their analytics, come up with hypotheses for them to test of what they should build next, prioritize the best hypotheses for them, and then our team at Clearhead will run experiments for them, and then we synthesize the data and in order to give them back confidence. That's basically the idea behind it, is that we want to give them confidence through data that the decision that they're making is the right one. You might know Emiliano.
Me.
He's the co-founder of this meetup, also co-founder of Chuck Norris' product at Student Loan Genius, which is the 401k of student loans. If you've not talked to him about hit that, you absolutely should.
Yeah, please. But why don't we take just 30 seconds each person, let's just go around the room and very quickly just say what your product is as far as why you're here, and then where your product is at. So you have an MVP, do you have customers? Do you have a lot of customers, little customers? So just walk through that. You can.
Ash Moria, Spark 59. Actually, we changed names to Lean Stack. Yes, we have customers.
Very nice.
Hi, I'm Javed. I'm working on a product that's helps with finance capacity scheduling and custom manufacturing. Well, I have one signed up customer.
Customer, paying customer?
Yeah.
Very nice.
But disclaimer is I had an easy intro to that question.
As long as they're paying you, that's better than that. What do you guys got next?
Okay, I'm Chris. I teach tech and business courses. I'm kind of here just to check out the meetup group.
Great.
My name is Richard, and I develop products for the autism space, and I have 50 customers.
Great.
My name is Andy Hui, also in the awesome space, healthcare, have nonprofit company.
Did you guys know each other before?
No, we did not.
Wow, you sat right next to one another.
That's cool. Which is amazing. We've been talking a little bit about it. And so we're working with partners in the occupation therapy space.
Oh, very cool.
My name is Philip Kangas. I'm working on an app for use in the live music industry. I'm a functioning prototype. I've shown it to some musicians that have interest but have no customers. It's not available yet.
Okay.
My name is Jacqueline Gross. I work for Spiceworks, a development manager for the inventory product. Shit ton of customers, but my particular product has a little bit of a problem, or a big problem, with retention. So we're running experiments to try and figure out why.
And are you guys a SaaS product then?
No, we're not. We're a local application, help desk, inventory, network monitor, community. We've got, like, the community has, 5 million, 6 million users, 7 million now. I've got 600 downloads a day, but we still have some of the common problems of startups.
Cool.
My name is David Babbitt. I'm director of product at the same company, and so she covered the product pretty well.
my name is Chris. I started a e-commerce store, European product. Right now it has about 5,000, and I'm building it up maybe like 10, 15 over the next year. And launched it about a month and a half ago, and I'm looking for customers. And
I'm sorry, the 5,000 that was?
I've got about 5,000 products on there right now.
Okay.
Started it and look, we're actually working with this guy here to kind of develop a little bit further with some custom like apps as far as like product customization and things like that online. So you just brought me down here.
Okay. Cool. My name is Sam. I'm currently working a job, but I've always thought about a startup. In my job, I'm a software developer. And so I just came here to check it out and see if it works.
Cool.
What about you? My name is John Raven. I am starting up an incubator in the education space that's focused on mission-driven educators that want to become entrepreneurs. And so I'm actually here not so much for a product, but because I want to understand your methods and using in Canvas, Lean Stack type methodologies. And I actually emailed you, I don't know if you recall, but so I was hoping to soak in as much as I could from you guys. Greg?
I'm Roger Collin. I'm looking for a product of the Angel Choice.
Very nice.
Alan, director of product, a company called Inforce. We call ourselves the largest. So actually I have two new opportunities. I've got one internally that I'm taking on in a couple of weeks, we branded product from the ground up, and I have also an idea that I'm gestating in the behavioral health space, and I really just want to get to know more about the startup and how to fail fast and set my targets.
And are you guys B2C?
No, B2B.
B2B, okay. Very nice.
I'm Adam. Building an app to help people learn math better. And it's in development mode, and I'm just kind of hoping to kind of see the way it happens in the market.
Great.
Hi, I'm Amy, and I have an impression product. It's a digital product, and so it's B2C. Also, I have a lot of contacts in the corporate wellness space, so if anybody has any ideas and would like to take something to market, come see me. And I have a few customers, but the problem I'm having is basically with conversion. So I'm looking forward to learning.
Cool.
I am Arjun Gupta. I'm pursuing my MBA at McCombs and my internship at an accelerator. We've come up with a product that's an audio authoring platform that uses GPS and beacons as a trigger. So it can manipulate sound, it can play sound, it can merge different sounds, it can also play live sound, and we need to probably talk about it sometime. Yeah.
And is this for consumers or is this something you've licensed?
So currently we are targeting museums to build audio edit tools inside museums and to build interactive sound arts. But later on we want to open it to people, and where a creative artist can create something that he can sell on our platform for common consumers to use, or probably you as a consumer can build a story as you're walking around University of Texas and someone else can hear it.
Hi, my name is Hui. I am studying finance undergrad at Holmes. I met Arjun through my internship at the accelerator, and then we started working on the same startup together.
Cool.
Hi, my name is Brandilyn. I am working on a startup of my own. It's called Voice of Hair, and it's a platform that connects women of color to the best hairstylists and the best styles and the people who can provide them. I do have some customers and people who signed up for the service that I'm offering, but they're not all converting, so that's what I'm here to get.
Great. So for the guys who just walked in, everyone's just giving a quick 30 seconds, so why don't you guys?
Okay, my name is Marcelo. We are on the very beginning of our startup for e-banking software for the Brazilian market, focusing on credit unions and regional banking.
Cool.
I'm Mike Werner. I
myself on this project.
You, Frank?
Yeah, Frank Mendoza. I'm part of a startup right now called You Earned It. We're kind of going on my own and focused on analytics and a tool that's going to hopefully help Uber drivers.
Cool. So one thing I said earlier was...
just one more.
Oh, sorry.
My name is Willa O. I have been an IT consulting business. I've developed a field product, which is an extension of off-the-shelf software that automates a lot of IT operations. I kind of want to convert that field software into a commercial software, but don't know exactly how much, what it actually takes. So that's why.
Great. So are there any questions that are burning? So we have a very loose format of what we're gonna talk through tonight. But if anyone has any specific topic that they want us to try to cover, shout it out, I'll write it down, and then we'll either try to get it into the presentation that we're doing or not, or if we have time at the end, we can dive deeper into specific topics. So does anyone have like a funnel question, metrics, any type of, any questions right now?
So we are using Lean Stack, but I think our experiment design is not as efficient. So as good the market validation experiments that we've built. So,
uh-huh.
And I think if the topic is about that and how we can form it in a better manner, what data points we can collect, and how do you keep a track of it, that can be a good starting point.
Great.
Cool. What else? Anything else? You saw the title of the meetup, and you're like, I should go to that because I want to learn X.
I think related to that, our struggle has been trying to define the experiments and the tests to where we feel confident that the result that we see is, you know, actually leading center in a good direction. I just think that we kind of second guess ourselves at the end of every single one of them match. I know we definitely spend the most time trying to come up with what the hypothesis is and what the test is going to test it, and then in the end we still like second guess ourselves a ton. I just think that's the most important.
And so is that, so you're trying to tie the data, the results of the output of what you're seeing really back to that was the cause of what changed the behavior, or that's what we saw, that's why we saw the metrics move?
We debate that heavily because I don't think the experiments that we're running necessarily move any metrics.
Okay.
Yeah, there's a lot of family fashion.
Okay, great.
Cool. Anything else? Throw it out.
And if we can, same thing, as we're talking, something else pops up, we don't cover it, this is gonna be very interactive. Raise your hand, shut it out, and we'll get into it.
Cool. So, talking very high overview, why are we talking experiments and assumptions? What does this have to do with startups? What does this have to do with big business, small business? The reason we're talking about experiments and assumptions is that the goal here is to de-risk your great ideas or to find out they weren't any good in the first place. So I come from working with medium, large companies where development budget is huge and it's just a matter of what should we build. It's like we could go in any direction and build anything, so how do we prioritize what should be built? How do we get confidence in that decision? On the other end, more of Emiliano's background is working with smaller startups where your runway is smaller, you have to really, whatever you're gonna work on, that's gonna be your focus. And you have to make sure you're working on the right thing, otherwise your runway's gone and you have no customers on that. So again, the goal, confidence in your decision. You're not trying to make leaps of faith, you're trying to get data in order to validate what you're building. So to give you an example of one of the clients that we work with at Clearhead, we work with a SaaS product called Buildium. It's property management software for apartments, which I know nothing about. I've never managed an apartment complex. Their goal is lead generation, which is probably a common goal for a lot of you guys. So their landing page, so they have a lot of property managers coming trying to sign up. They had your typical like huge one page like value proposition. Let me show you screenshots of the product. Try now for free. Give me your email address and all of a sudden you're in. So they were seeing a decent amount of leads. It definitely wasn't a problem that they weren't getting any leads, but it was something that they felt like they could do a better job at. So they worked with us and we came up with a hypothesis. So we're gonna dig more into hypothesis a little bit further on and kind of these terms and details, but our hypothesis for them was, I believe that by having a survey, I believe that having a survey would drive more qualified leads and increase conversion rate. So we took this page, we took out all of like your typical value prop down here. We just put some testimonials at the bottom. And instead of our main CTA being click here for a free trial, we said, is Buildium right for you? So what that launched is an actual survey. So instead of asking for just an email address, we started getting information from them. So what's your number one goal? What do you want the software to do for you? What level of support are you looking for? So best practice would obviously tell you reduce friction to sign up, always. Like less steps a user takes, the better. Best practices is in quotes because we feel like everything should be tested. Everything's different for each business. So our findings were asking more questions, drove over a 5% lift in free trial signups, and reduced bounce rate by nearly 36%. This is also great because instead of getting just a blind email address that their sales team's now marketing to, they're able to get a little more qualified leads. So it's people that completed the survey, we have data on what they're looking for the software to do for them. And as they're filling out the survey, we're able to kind of cater our value prop to the questions that they answered. So this is a type of an experiment where they had a goal. The goal was more lead gen. A couple different ways that we could do that. We came up with a ton of hypotheses, and this is the one that we felt like we wanted to go after. So 5% lift in free trial signups ended up, I can't remember the actual conversion to paid customers, but it was about 11% additional revenue per month for this like kind of small, medium-sized company, just based on asking people more questions at the very start. So experiments are not just conversion rate optimization. So I hope you didn't come in talking about green buttons and red buttons. I mean, I can talk about this for a long time. But we're gonna be doing a lot more media tests than this. If you're Google and you can A-B test, they did like 67 different versions of blue and tested all of that because they have a million traffic and it was very significant for them, that's great. But Emiliano can give you an example of lean canvas. So Buildium, we had a decent amount of traffic that we're able to make a big change and measure it on a big scale. But experiments and assumptions can also be used to validate a business model, can be used to validate a smaller site, and you can give an example of that.
Yeah, so I know in the room we're going to have people who, some of you guys are sort of in that problem solution stage where you have an idea for a business model, so we'll talk about that towards the second half. But I think one of the important distinctions is a lot of people have ideas that they've already been thinking about for a long time. And so in the example of Lean Canvas, we at the time had done a very basic landing page. And me coming with a design background, I didn't want to show it to any of my friends. Like I was like, oh, this landing page is terrible. And so I ended up doing a,
this one?
Yeah, let me pull it up.
I'll pull it up while you talk.
So we ended up doing a new landing page and we were split testing this. And it was very interesting because I showed this page to like three other friends who were designers. I got a lot of feedback and everyone was like, yes, this is a much better landing page. And the results ended up turning out that the page that I did actually performed worse. And if I hadn't split it up as a split landing page, I would have literally felt 100% confident that the page I had designed was going to work better. Every single element of it, from the headline to like, I changed the design, I changed the call to action, I changed the social proof. There were all these elements in here. But at the end of the day, so I did a split test and all this stuff, and it wasn't even like, it wasn't even a small difference, it was a big difference where this one did 20%. But the lesson I really learned from this was that, all of these experiments that we're going to be trying to talk about and getting into, all of them should be additive. So after this experiment failed, I immediately went out and I ran a new experiment. I simplified it and I tried to isolate what had gone wrong. Instead of changing all of the copy, all I literally did was change the polish. I made it look a lot prettier. So I was able to isolate, well, is this really the factor that's contributing to the conversion of it or not? And through that, it was the same thing. It actually ended up being a wash again.
but we ended up sticking with this experiment, or we stuck with the newer page because we were prouder of it, and there wasn't that big of a difference of conversion. And the reason why I didn't continue really going off and trying to dive deeply into getting this perfect landing page is because our top level goal was we were trying to increase acquisition. We were just trying to get people into the tool. And so this was only one branch of the experiments that we were running at the time. So in parallel to that, we were also doing some SEO optimization. And we were also starting to set up these partnerships with universities and incubators. So when we took a broader view of all the different things that we could do, it wasn't worth the time to continue investing here. So that's the first exercise that we're going to do is we're going to talk about actually identifying our main goal or our main assumption. So I'll pass out some post-it notes, and everyone is just going to write that down for themselves. And from there, the next exercise is going to be starting to write out all the potential experiments. We're going to go through a big brainstorming session. But this example is really just to illustrate how we can get very focused on an idea, an experiment that we think we should run, feel very confident about it. But when you take a step back, there's usually about 7 or 8 different things that you can do that are very obvious. And then from Brandon's experience, when you guys are working with a client, how many experiments do you guys normally like to seed with them?
So when we first sign a client for an engagement, we fly out and do a full day brainstorm with them. So it's very similar to this. We kind of give them the overview of what is the hypothesis. We give them an overview of what our agency does. Then we bring in team members from all their different departments. So we just did one with Build-A-Bear yesterday, which is very interesting. They are alive and kicking it, which I did not know. But our typical clients, I went out to Vitamix and we did a 3-hour brainstorm with 20 team members, and we came up with 70 experiments. So from there, we just see that if you can get a high volume of experiments, you kind of get a lot of the crap out of the way and you can get into the bigger goals. So as they're talking about, we think we should do this, we're able to piece that down in order to find the main goal and start seeing themes around the main things they want to improve with their business. So typical engagement, 70 experiments that we then narrow down, depending on the contact, to 5 to 10 that we actually test for them.
You just literally write down one of the colors.
That idea that you have
break out.
Is that based on somebody's idea from you guys have seen it before, or was that kind of looking at the competition? Sometimes I'm not sure which.
Right, this is where hypothesis comes. So that one game was just something they had in their head. They always wondered, is this something that we should do? We don't even know. But the benefit of hiring us to do it is we can do it a lot cheaper and give them the data on, is this something we should actually do? Versus them going out and implementing it blindly and not knowing whether it's going to do poorly or not. Hypotheses can come from looking at your analytics data, your customer service, quality of talking to customers, competition, number of sources.
And we'll get into, we're going to keep on going deeper and deeper. So right now, let's take 2-3 minutes, write down what you think the one goal is. If you're not sure, if you're on the business model side, we can talk about those, but also talk to your neighbors. This is going to be very collaborative. So one goal, whether it's finding customers, whether it's increasing conversion, whether it's if you want to make it broader and say, I want to double my price, just identify one thing.
It's a website.
I guess I'll just keep on. I'll definitely continue.
This is my thing.
Customer segments to focus on.
Nice, very good. So you guys are on the business model side first.
Yep.
Okay. What about you?
Increasing all signups.
Increasing signups.
Yes.
Clear. Very nice.
So for mine, it's just to increase conversion from landing page to sales.
And is that the, are there a lot of steps in between that?
I've been doing a lot of direct advertising, but
okay.
The challenge right now is the cost for me to acquire a customer is actually more than the product itself a lot of times.
Yep.
So I'm trying to figure out like what needs to be done in order to optimize that landing page.
But so from if someone signs up, are they paying you right there? So is there a funnel in between someone signs up, they test out the product, there's a 30-day trial?
No, it's basically they just pay right. They can make your link instantly pay right away.
Okay.
And then I have like a 60-day guarantee. So
okay.
Refund rate actually isn't a big deal, but it's just basically for me right now, but it's just the cost of acquiring a customer. So So the sales base, in essence, is not converting.
Okay. Sounds good.
For mine, it's just identifying whether it's a problem people are willing to pay for. Solution.
That's it. That's all you have to figure out.
It's
simple,
man.
Yeah, done. We'll figure it out tonight. It'll be good. You'll get a good night's sleep.
Exactly. I'm sleeping well tonight. Looking forward to it.
Okay.
Safe market validation.
Okay.
So they're there.
Along the same lines, building something that's valued.
Okay. Good. What about you guys back there?
Increasing traffic to their website.
Okay. Very nice.
Conversion to the second interview.
I like it. I have an assumption that foundations are going to want to fund my computer.
There you go.
I want to test basically converting a type of customer from not paying to paying. That's really what it is. But we can go into it. They sign up for free, and it's supposed to be that way. But then there are some additional like premium features that they can pay for.
And could they buy this right now, or is this stuff you're gonna?
It is basically in the pipeline, so it's within the next, I would say, 2 weeks, we can test it for real.
Okay, very cool.
Yeah.
Improve retention.
Great. And just on that, is there a specific duration of time? Are you guys looking first week, 30 days, 60 days?
Our definition of retention is you have at least one impression and then you have 60 days.
60 days, okay, great.
Finding ways to optimize the filtering process for customers to find the desired path. I'm the desired product faster. So like he was saying that there are so many products that the customer doesn't know what to look for necessarily. So like ways to find the product they want faster. Like similar products, different products.
Everything I sell is basically modern furniture out there. And it's like a very wide price range. Like I have a table that's like 200 and I have tables that are like over 10,000 and different aesthetics.
Yeah.
It's actually one of the only stores like in the country that actually has the full range of all these different brands.
Yep. But the challenge I would ask you, so that seems like a sort of like a value UX issue. How do you measure that? Is it because, are you guys gonna look at the number of people who put something in a shopping cart, or do you care more about sales? Could you make that goal more concrete?
Keeping it on the page longer, like if they're navigating to a certain category and they're gonna see a lot of things that might be way out of their price range, they might just like go away. That's what a lot of people like in my focus groups have said. They think it's like way overpriced when there's a lot I've got like filtering options, but
What is it from like a business goal, right? So as far as not from like even almost like a, are you at the end of the day, are you trying to drive more sales? Are you trying to get more people? So you could, obviously you want to get more revenue, but you could be that I want to get more people to do their first time purchase. I want people to start buying higher items. I think the thing that's hard about putting something in a cart or just even measuring time on a page, you could have an incredibly confusing site where people are clicking around everywhere and you're gonna get a lot of time versus you can have a page that you're helping connect people to products and they're gonna spend a lot of time. So it's hard to make that distinction from both of those as which one is actually leading to a business goal for you. So think about it and then we'll come back. But I think try to make it more concrete as far as I'm trying to get people to purchase, right? And maybe it's first time purchases or I'm trying to get higher purchases. Any thoughts on that?
I think it sums it up. I like it.
Cool.
I'm not quite at this phase with my project, but I know this will be the hardest thing I have to do, and it's to get people to download the app, to use it, and not delete it.
Okay. And do you have a product that can be downloaded right now?
It is not available.
Okay.
I have a functioning prototype.
So if you take a step back from that, why do you think they won't download it?
I just incredibly hard to get people to download apps and to use it. And it's one of those things that has to work. And there's two sides to this, musician side and the fan side. So if they get no value from it immediately, then they just won't use it.
Yeah, and so
reaching them anyway is incredibly hard to get people to download anything.
I think that's really good in that you're forecasting prompt, but for the stage of where you're at right now, it might be better to make that more of get get 10 pilot bands and customers, or try to make it something, you know.
That's a good one.
Yeah.
Yeah, beyond like getting a new customer to sign up because they're getting something free,
mm-hmm.
getting them to make a purchase.
Sure. So you want to increase your free trials to paid customers.
Right.
Great.
So improve referrals.
Thanks.
You know, getting people to sort of, I guess, improve the process of word of mouth.
Mm-hmm.
Being able to provide a system on, I guess, either an app or a website
mm-hmm.
to make it easy for that.
Sure. And here's an amazing question. Do you have anything in your tool right now or in your service where you ask people for a referral?
I'm not currently. I mean, like, that's what I've been playing with,
yep.
is the different, you know, options that are out there.
Good.
Yeah.
Very good. So you're perfect. This is what you're doing next. Very nice.
Okay, so if the customer can't or won't validate what you're offering, at least find out, can you get them to tell you what it is that you want? So if you don't get a say, at least get an opinion.
Yeah, and there's ways, we'll get into when we actually start sort of constructing tests. We'll talk about this idea of like how to use a proxy when I, you know, I don't have my app yet, or I'm still thinking about the service. What are ways that I can go out and test demand or price points? So there are lots of ways to do that.
I guess for me specifically, it would be encouraging partners to try out the products and give us feedback rapidly.
Okay. Is there a number? Like, what do you think would be for the stage of where you're at right now? How many partners would be a good goal for you?
It's not about the number of partners, but about the quality of the feedback that they are able to give to us.
What's good quality feedback for you? Like, well, how do you distinguish that?
It's quantitative, basically. Quantitative data that we can use to improve the products that they can reuse for the trials.
And do you, so how do you get that? You actually have metrics set up where you can pull that quantitative data from them using the tool? What's the metric that matters most?
It's a metric that matters.
Yeah, like what is, so if you're doing quantitative, is there one interaction with the tool that matters most to you? Is it retention?
Like I mean, they're sensory, so sensory data gathering.
Okay, we'll come back.
My goal is actually when the customer started actually first to try my product, at least, and then hopefully purchase the product. Because currently they're using the off-the-shelf vendor's product.
Mm-hmm.
The way they use it is very menu, very time consuming, and then very eloquent right now. There's really nothing else out there to automate the whole thing. I think the market is very, very new. So I think the first step I really just really need to get their awareness. There's something that you know they can purchase and which will make their life.
But is your product built? Is your product, do you have an MVP right now? Can the product be purchased?
The product was currently is a field product, meaning it was developed for specific clients.
Mm-hmm.
In order to make them commercial, I would have to make a substantial amount of change.
Okay, so you don't have a, so.
I don't have a finished commercialized product yet.
Right, okay. And I'll just touch upon that real quick. So I mean, that's one of the things is, if you don't have a product yet, your biggest risk is going to be, am I actually building something that people want?
Right.
And Ash talks a lot about this. But the thing here that we really always want to try to do is, and we'll go to it when we start sort of listing up some of the ways is, the classic trap that I've seen entrepreneurs do is they go out and they build their product. They spend $40,000 or they spend $100,000 to hire someone to build their product where they put their own blood and sweat into it, and then they release it, and no one cares. Literally, like, you get 20 downloads, you get 30 downloads, and it's your mom and your friends, and then from there, it just nosedives. And the big idea there is, well, then usually what someone does is, well, they start asking all these questions. You said you were interested in my product, you said you really wanted to use it, but no one's signing up. So the big idea that we try to do in Lean is, rather than stacking those questions at the end when we've already spent $60,000 in 6 months building the product, what if we take those questions and put it at the beginning to use that as a validation that yes, there are people who actually have a need for this problem, have a painful problem, and I can build a solution that is actually going to be worthwhile in that it's a big enough market size, there's revenue there that lets me build the kind of business that I want to build. So.
If you think about like the lean startup build measure learn loop, it does not have to start with build. Like you can absolutely start learning before you even touch any sort of development.
Yeah, and I think what lean has done a really good job of is showing people all these different ways to do proxies. So you can use smokescreen tests, you can use Kickstarter. There are all of these ways to go out and start getting a sense of demand from customers by putting things that look like you have the product, but you're just trying to get a ballpark measurement on their intent. You know, would people actually click sign up, even though I don't have the product, so.
But the issue is actually not the demand or not, because you know, my field kind of improved, there's a big demand. The issue is whether or not they're willing to buy a commercial product or they want to just
custom.
Help me build a customized solution.
Yeah.
That's the big difference. Because they've been doing that, building customized solution for years and years and years. Commercial product out there. It's the reason they always say my business is different. Yep, just like, you know, the house building business, right? Everybody say my house has to be different.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we don't want the mass print, you know, produce the housing, and we want to customize the housing. We want to hire our own architect.
That sounds like your number one goal then. If that's your riskiest assumption that they are going to want a commercial solution.
Right now, and that's the part.
Your goal should be to figure that out.
Right.
Figure out how to do that.
That's the biggest risk right now.
Yeah, cool. Figure out more customer segments. What are the other customer segments that I can track down?
Great.
For us, we know customer education can be hard, and maybe sometimes it doesn't work, but we are focusing on the Brazilian markets first, and people don't. The truth is people don't like doing e-banking in Brazil because they don't trust the devices, they think they can be hacked, and the laws don't protect customer there compared to what we see here. And for instance, the e-commerce took a while to take off in Brazil because of that, and we think we might have the same issues. This is one of our biggest concerns, the how customer will trust our product, our software.
Great.
Almost what you said, maybe the question should be come first, then the product itself. They will accept?
Yeah.
How they will accept?
And we can talk about, I think maybe a good analog for you guys is simple credit card. They were basically trying to combine Mint with a credit card.
Mm-hmm.
And so, what they were able to do is they were able to just create a very compelling landing page offer. And I don't know the exact numbers, but they probably got something like 100,000 people who signed up and said, I want this product. And from that, they were able to show that, hey, you know, we don't have the product built yet, but what's more important to that is we have people who are signing up who are saying, yes, we want this, right? So for you guys, it might be a very compelling demo or explanation that really proves that, hey, there is a large enough market. It's not just 2,000 people who want to use this.
Yeah, we know eventually it's going to happen. People will start using, but we don't know.
Do you guys want to be the first company that, you know, creates the market but doesn't have
it? Yes.
Yeah.
For me, yeah, launch a new book.
Launch a new book? What is that new book called?
Working Title Scalingly.
Okay, nice. So you can give the second half of the workshop. We'll set the primer.
Yes.
And then you can come in and do the second half. Okay, awesome. And actually, I'll do my business. So for Student Loan Genius, we basically invented the 401k for student loans. Our challenge is that we are doing enterprise sales. We're all B2B. This is a benefit that a company can provide for their employees. And so we are trying to increase sales. We will have an operational issue, like as we turn on some bigger companies, we're going to have to figure out how do we handle 10,000 people instead of the 500 people we're handling right now. So our number one goal is driving sales.
We're going to make you write out some hypotheses too.
I will write out some hypotheses.
Just a quick question.
Yeah.
If your problem is actually how do you handle 10,000 people, isn't it handling customer onboarding not really skills?
Well, it's not my problem right now. The moment, so example, we're talking with Enterprise Rental. They hire 9,000 people a year. The moment Enterprise says yes, my focus is going to be how do I handle that many people coming through it? But we'll probably be talking to them for 6 months. So why should I go off? And there are certain things that we can do now as far as like planning and understanding. But should I spend $50,000 right now to scale my operations for a client that's going to take 6 months and might back out because you know, some CFO comes in and says, I don't want to spend the money on that. So and the way that we always sort of characterize this, it's a good, bad problem to have. If you have that problem where you have so many people who are coming in and you can't keep up with the demand of people who want to use your tool, well, that's a fantastic problem, right? That's where you can, you have good traction, whether you go out and raise some money to help you scale or you do something else. You'd rather be at that than having spent the $50,000 and then the scale never happens.
I wasn't going to show this slide, but I'm going to show it now. So what we went through and we talked about is kind of your main goals. So goal is obviously the first thing. When we go out and talk to clients, everyone has ideas of what they want to change with their site, especially when you talk about these giant companies where they move very slowly. It takes them a long time to get anything through the development queue, prioritized or developed. So for them, we get in there, they're all very excited. They're like, oh my God, we have this awful video carousel on the homepage. Like, let's just remove that and put in like a really sexy picture. So getting all of that out of the way, it's like breaking it down to like, okay, what's the actual, why are you wanting to do that? What is that going to do for your business? So what we try to get them to is a hypothesis. So a hypothesis is a tentative assumption made in order to draw and test its logical or empirical consequences. That's a really wordy definition. Hypothesis is basically, it's like a phrase that you're gonna believe in, that's something that you can implement and test. So whether you're testing it qualitative or quantitatively, you're gonna come back and you're gonna see, was this validated or not? So when we have an assumption, so to use my awful example, video carousel, they want to change it with like a huge hero image. Their assumption is that that huge hero image is going to perform better than the video. So no matter what their goal is, maybe the video is not getting plays and they think the hero image is going to lead to more free trial signups or more clicks on that engagement to go buy a product. How can we change this assumption of like, hey, we need to get rid of that video, to a hypothesis like, I believe that by putting a hero image that showcases our products, we're going to see X amount of lift in clicks and sales on this product. So what we want to do now is that, now that you guys have kind of put your goals together, or hopefully your one single goal, is the hard challenge of coming up with a lot of hypotheses that you can actually put into place in order to test these. So the goal is the easy part. Goal should be like your focus, like that's what you want to build your business around. So what's a good hypothesis? We at Clearhead, we like to do this form. So I believe that blank, we will see blank. So I believe that by doing this, we're going to see this sort of result. So a good hypothesis needs to be written down. It needs to be falsifiable. So it can't just be, you know, I believe that by doing this, customers are going to like it more. That can't really be falsified unless you're actually doing like full qualitative. And even then, customers will tell you they like anything. And Emiliano likes to do time box. This is something where we differ on a little bit just because of the clients that we work with, but you can talk about time box.
Yeah, so when we're talking about this stuff, is the way that I think a path is really good is gonna be, if you guys write out a hypothesis, you could give it to anyone else in this room. They can look at your data and they would say yes or no, you were able to actually achieve that. So that's really the falsifiable. The reason that I think time box is really important, you know, for some of you guys who don't have a business model, and the first thing is going to be, you might want to say, well, I want to do 20 solution interviews. And from my personal experience and having worked with other startups, you say you want to do 20 solution interviews and you're going to say, I expect to get 15 out of 20 people to say, yes, I would sign up for that product. Usually the first thing that happens is you can't get 20 people to talk to you in 2 weeks. Usually what happens is you get 3 people and 5 people flake out. And so the reason that we do the time boxing is to get us closer to the reality of that our time is limited. The main advantage of Startup has is being able to cycle through these experiments really fast. So whether it's because you can't get enough clients, whether it's because you don't have enough time, one of the clients that I advised, he wanted to do a certain amount of, he wanted to do an experiment, and he literally could not dedicate enough hours to it. And that to him was getting him closer to the reality of that. 2 weeks ago, I predicted that I was going to be able to get this thing done. 2 weeks later, I've made this amount of progress, right? So we write this down on a sheet of paper, we make it falsifiable, whether it's this format or another one, and then at the end you time box it, right? So both you and everyone else on your team can look at that, and you have a very clear line in the sand as far as this is what I expected to happen. Now, let's look through the data, let's have a conversation, and let's analyze how do we learn lessons from what just happened and run our next experiment. So for this part right now, you've identified your goal. Start writing up all of the actions that you could do. So for some of you guys who wanted to increase acquisition, you can test out driving Facebook ads. You can give a presentation. Start writing all of just the different possible ways that you could achieve that goal. Here we're looking for just straight up quantity. We'll come back to, after we have a good little list of them, we'll talk about ways to actually start filtering which ones become winners and we actually try to execute on. Any questions?
On the deck that you emailed out, I thought it was interesting that you had kind of like, I want to increase acquisition like 20% or something like
yeah.
that, right? How do you choose that number? It seems sort of arbitrary.
That's a great question. So a lot of things that we did, we had very clear sort of quarterly and yearly goals as far as we were trying to hit X amount of sales. And so because we had a funnel, we sort of knew where we needed to be throughout the year to reach those targets. I think you can sort of do it in two different ways. That's sort of like a top-down approach where we have business goals that we're trying to go out and achieve. The other way that you can do it is if you have an experiment that you feel that you want to run, like when I did the landing page example, I knew that wasn't going to increase conversion by 20%. So you can either sort of be agnostic and try to find the best experiment that's going to hit that target, or you can look at the experiment itself and say, okay, well, I think that leads to a 5% increase.
And different styles of doing it, but we've run, you know, across 6 months, we'll run hundreds of tests for 25 clients, and we can never predict what the actual list is going to be. The results will always surprise you, and that's part of it is that...
Keep that inside the room also, I don't think
that. No, we're okay with that. The reason that we're testing is because you're trying to find out these unknowns. So if we knew it was going to be 20%, then it would be great. But the way we're able to go not around that, we're very direct with that, is that we think it is going to provide a significant increase. And your question, we're going to talk a little bit more about when we talk about how to prioritize hypotheses, is kind of that estimated impact.
I could follow it through and just say if I found something that was 10% better, then you know I guess I could put it in place while I continue searching for another one that's you know in total 20% better than one.
Yeah. So maybe to like look ahead. So I think the other thing that we start looking at is you know if you're looking at just the conversion rate, that's sort of an incomplete experiment. You also need to look at the actual cost of implementing it. You know, if it's going to be 20%, but it's going to take you guys 600 hours versus that 10%, which is going to take 60 hours, one is obviously a much bigger, one is much bigger of a cost, and there's probably actually a greater risk with it. So that's the thing that we'll start doing when we get further into it. But for right now, just brainstorm. I have extra pens. I have extra post-its. So if you need one, just raise your hand. I'll throw that to you or one of those.
Oh, you're getting thrown everything.
All right, anyone else? Just write them up with the post-its on the table. Just write them out. I would shout that you're going to say like 50 or 20.
Yeah.
I'm going to take a break.
Yeah.
We basically do this whole time.
Yeah, I'm just going to
cards. The company with the transaction gets on the database, the bank is transaction. They get on the next week, they get like a response.
I think it's I'm going to try to find a more teacher.
That's one that, like, you just turn the numbers if you can just see a lower conversion. But you lose the
I'm
I'm trying to figure out my business model, much harder, because I think you're trying to answer a lot of questions that you don't have a product that you can put in place. So we'll talk about that. But people who had funnels, a lot of it was what point of the funnel do I actually really like hone in on? I do think it is easier when you have a funnel because it's easier for you to just say, I did this, I get this back. When you're doing the pre-business model stuff, it's all about how you interpret and who do you go out and see. So it is naturally harder.
Yeah, definitely. Cool. So by this point, we hope you guys have a decent amount of hypotheses. So we want to talk a little bit about how to prioritize them. So very simple. Oh, wow, you like can't see this at all. You see that there's 9 squares here? This is like, I feel like this is a colorblind test. So very simple way to kind of score your hypotheses. So there's a lot of things that you potentially could do. Thank you. So what we like to do is we want to measure level of effort and potential impact. So you can actually draw a grid if you'd like. You can stick your post-it notes on there. Your sweet spot is something, so level of effort. What's this going to be? So this is, how hard is this thing going to be to test? Am I going to have to spend a ton of development hours? Like, am I going to have to do 20 solution interviews?
Hard, easy? Like little high effort, low effort?
Yes, low effort, high effort. Okay. Your graph's even better than mine. So yeah, high level of effort is like, man, we gotta put huge functionality, huge features into our site in order to test this. Potential impact, this is kind of the guessing game, a little bit of art and science of what you think your experiment's gonna lead to. So your experiment is like, I think if I, you know, created an email newsletter, I'd get more people to visit my blog, which is then gonna, you know, make them sign up for my free trial. Potential impact, probably low, medium. Doesn't mean it's not worth doing, especially if it's a low level of effort. But anything that is low level of effort that is gonna be a killer impact is the one that you wanna watch out for. I mean, those are the good ones that you should immediately go after. So it's something that you can easily implement that you think is gonna be beneficial to your business, whether that's through revenue or through learnings. So if you think that by going out and talking to 10 users after they try your product, that's very low level of effort for you as long as you have time. Potential impact to get feedback from that is definitely like a medium to high. So this is a very easy way to score your hypotheses and to figure out which ones to kind of go after. Want to talk a little bit, any questions on this before we move on from that? Cool. want to talk a little bit about different types of experiments?
So the way that I like to break down experiments, I like to break them down into predictive experiments and throughput experiments. So a good example of this, when we were building user cycle, our goal is same thing. We were trying to drive acquisition. We were trying to get just people to the top of the funnel. We had a 30-day trial. And so for us, it was all about getting people at the top. We knew once someone was in the tool, we had pretty good conversion numbers. And so one of the things that we were getting a lot of feedback from our customers was saying, you don't have this custom reporting feature. If you had that custom reporting feature, I would be interested in trying out your tool. And so internal discussion, we knew that building out that feature was probably going to be, I think it was something like 200 hours. So it was a pretty big feature development for us. So, you know, I think to me that's always a red flag when I'm thinking about doing something that's going to have a high amount of effort, even if it has the potential to do the big impact. What you want to try to do is think about, well, is there some way that I can go out and test this to get some sort of qualitative feedback? So what we were able to do is we were, actually, it wasn't this feature, it was for Lean Stack. I was able to create a very similar functionality using a Google Excel sheet. And then I got onto a phone call. I reached out to about 20 different customers and I showed them that functionality. I walked them through, we talked about it. And the fantastic thing for us was that I was able to really start getting a sense of, yes, this is what people want. And not because they told me that they enjoyed it, but after having gone through it, I was getting email follow-ups from customers who were asking me, is this something I can share with my friends? Is it okay if I download it? Is it okay if I use it? And so people were reaching out to me. I hadn't told them that they could use it in any way whatsoever after our conversation. But what it was helpful for is that I had a strong feeling that it was going to work, but it wasn't until I got into the Excel and actually getting hands-on that I got to get, that I got people's feedback. But what we ended up building ended up being actually like much smaller from having done these one-on-one sessions. The value prop that I thought that people really wanted ended up being different. So, you know, for people who don't have products yet, the way to think about this is building my product is going to be very risky. Maybe I still have 3 months to have the finished product that I think that I want. What if you just create a demo video, right? That's what you do in place for your product. You put it on a landing page and you tell people that I'm about to start an open beta, or even just say email sign up. And you can use the video as a predictive intent. If people go to this landing page, are they interested enough where they would want to download it or they would want to sign up? Another good example of this is like Kickstarter. I think Kickstarter almost exemplifies the perfect way to do a predictive test is that you say, I have this product that is going to do this. Sometimes people don't even have the product built. They just have a rendering that Kickstarter has gotten closer to. You need to have a working prototype. But even if you look at like when someone's going to do a movie, you know, they might have storyboards and they might have a 30-second trailer and they're able to sort of talk about this big thing that I want to do. But for me to do this, I need to raise $100,000. And so what they do there is you're able to say, well, I know what it is for me to break even or for me to make this worth my time. But the assumptions that we're testing are, well, one, do people actually want to take money out of their wallet and support me or give it to me? The second thing is, can I then actually reach enough people? Because for some of the people here, you know, especially if you're a developer, your risk isn't, can you build this? You know, you have a development background. For the most part, you can either do it yourself or you can hire someone else out. But the question I posed was, well, if you had your product live today, how would you get 1,000 people to it, right? So that's where, separating the predictive to, maybe can we pull up the slide?
Yeah.
The predictive versus throughput. The throughput is all about you have a funnel and you know if I do this, so let's say if I had a new feature, it's going to increase my conversion by 10%. I measure the end of my funnel, that's worth $100,000 more in sales. The predictive is, well, should I spend the time to actually go off and get into building that feature. What else?
It's on your link canvas one?
No, it's on this one. Yeah. So who here has, like, let's look at who here has what they feel like would be, would be a risky, like who has sort of like an experiment that they feel is risky? Or there's like a high build cost, yeah, what is it?
Well, there's existing technology that can be used to identify you just from the signature of your eye movement. Okay, now it's not iris recognition, it's just,
okay.
Now, can you take that technology and find a movement that is unique to autism in the eye of a 10-week old child?
Okay.
Okay. So you need $100,000 to conduct that research.
So for you, is it risky? Are you more afraid of that there's a technological risk, or are you more afraid that people would pay me to develop this?
The risk is, the technology definitely works in one area,
uh-huh.
but it's not known if it will work in another. It's proven in one area, but not in another.
So if I gave you $1 million, would you be able to, do you feel confident that you would be able to solve it? Like, is there a dollar amount that you feel you need to hit, or is it just, you don't know, this may not be feasible?
I think you could do it for $1 million.
Okay, I'm not gonna get you that check, but.
Autism, or are you, what is the eye test?
I'm trying to identify the signature of autism in particular eye movement.
Yes.
But it's not concentration. Everybody's doing concentration, everybody's measuring concentration, but that's not what this is. This is about eye signature.
Well, so the expensive spend is to get it like scientifically validated, but what's your confidence that this works? Have you done any tests whatsoever? That's where I would start.
I think if they are using technology just to measure concentration, just how many seconds a child can follow a dot across, you know, I mean, that's really, really crude stuff, then with enough money, you would definitely find something. I'm confident you would find something.
Well, that's just one aspect of the exam, right? It's all of that. It's right, making the diagnostic, meeting the diagnostic criteria for autism. That's one thing. You just watch the doctor or something. There are other things they have to look at.
Correct. And after you get that result, then a doctor has to verify that this is, in fact, a child with autism. So that's, you're right, yeah. So the eye tracking does not define autism, okay? But this is what eye signature is attempting to do. It's attempting to cut the cost of identifying autism by thousands of times.
So I think for most entrepreneurs, they're not gonna have a technological risk. You sound like you're on more of, you're sort of on the cutting edge of doing research and trying to prove something scientifically.
Right.
You know, for most people who are trying to sell a product, if you have an e-commerce store, your risk is not, can I go off from Europe and find products that people want to buy in the US? That's proven out.
I think what's common there though is, are we looking at a third dimension instead of just efforts, and impact is really the confidence level.
Mm-hmm.
That should govern whether you should invest in that or not, because if you have a low confidence level of the result actually is relevant. Or another example is maybe the sample size that you're able to get to, right?
Mm-hmm.
If the sample size is small enough that you don't even have one standard deviation of confidence, that might not be worth investing into that expense at all.
Yeah, and that's, I mean, I think that sort of leads back to this breaking down of predictive versus throughput. You know, the one of the examples that we did, like this was a really good thing that we did when we were doing, before Lean Stack ever existed, we actually created a keynote file, and we were able to sell that keynote file in place of doing all the development. But the reason we did this is we didn't have the confidence. We didn't have the guarantee that people would actually want to start using it and buying it. And so we started off doing an internal keynote. And from that, we created a landing page where Ash had basically walked through. I think it was like a 3 or 4 minute demo video. But we were able to put something in place of it. And it was the sales that we started seeing from this that gave us the justification to go out and start investing in building a larger tool. You know, similar to that, the one that I really love and that I would recommend most people do is doing some sort of smokescreen test for the people who don't have product yet, and where you talk about your customer acquisition cost. You know, Google, Facebook, they'll give you $75 for free where you can go off and run any kind of ad that you want. Create a fake landing page, make it look like you have your product, and see what it costs. If you run an ad, how many people can you drive to your page? How much is it going to cost you to get them there? But then more importantly, measure how many people click on that button. And you can say, hey, learn more about this product, right? You don't even have to make it, you don't even have to say that you have it, just say learn more. And what that lets you do is, it gives you a sense of, well, if 50 people land on the page and 2 people click on that button, well, you've learned something. Either I'm targeting the wrong person, I've got the wrong value prop, but you can learn that lesson without actually having to go off and build your product and then coming back and realizing that, you know, I was targeting the wrong person or I was highlighting the wrong features in my product, right? So for me, it's really about, you know, it's just this. You don't have the confidence or you don't have the evidence. And so what are ways that you can go out, whether it's through having conversations with people, whether it's through trying to drive traffic through things that appear like your product, it's what are the tactics that we can do to start getting a sense that, yes, this is something that's worth doing.
I like the word evidence here because I don't know what the gentleman here is talking about, but I hear the word confidence just because if you have a strong intuition or you feel like you have the answer and you think that that is guidance for what you don't need to test it, then I call BS on that.
Yeah, and the landing page example I talked about, Lean Canvas, that destroyed my confidence in myself as someone who could predict what other people would do. So between that experiment and then having Ash, I literally have zero confidence. But in a lot of ways, it's actually a lot more liberating. It's like I have to rely less on my...
No, it's totally...
Yeah, it's like I rely less on my intuition, and I have a process instead. I know that instead of trying to hit this home run landing page, I just iterate on it. Sometimes it's going to work, sometimes it's not going to. But what's more consistent is going up and always having that process, these small tests that help you learn and then adjust your course from it.
Can you explain on the previous slide when you said you all use the keynote, you mean like the program is similar to PowerPoint, you use that? How did you use that?
Yeah, so the bigger difference of what Lean Stack was doing here was it was actually trying to get into tracking your experiments and doing sort of your, trying to build a funnel and trying to do all of this reporting around it. Previous to that, Lean Canvas could only really do some commenting features, but it didn't do anything for, hey, these are the experiments that we're starting to run. So what we started doing is, I have these for you guys. We created these experiment report templates. And we started documenting, and this is going to be sort of where we end for tonight. We started documenting the experiments that we were coming out and trying to run. And so it's something that started off internally from the workshops that Ash did, from the conversations that we had. We knew a lot of people were having a hard time just building the rhythm of, hey, this is how we go out and talk about the experiments to our internal team. And so rather than waiting to, like, we built a keynote file, we shared that keynote file in Dropbox, and so the product that we sold was literally the keynote / PowerPoint presentation, and in this video, Ash explained how we used it internally, and so it wasn't for all of the people. There were a ton of people who didn't want to have a keynote file, but there were plenty of people who were happy to pay us. I think we were selling it for $39, so it was a one-time download. You got future access to any revisions that we made on it.
If I can just add, I'll say that the riskiest thing here was really the template and the way of thinking.
Yeah.
So even Lean Canvas before it was an online tool, it was just it was a Keynote file as well. It was something I use in workshops, printed it out, had people write on it. And by them using it, we learned what worked and didn't work, and I changed some of the boxes there, and then that became the online tool. So it's essentially the rinse and repeat of that.
Yeah.
That even though we are all software, most of the people on the team could build this pretty quickly, the bigger risk was, you know, we build this, we think it'll take us 2 weeks, but by the time you test it and put it out there, it's like 4 weeks, 6 weeks. It costs a lot of time, money. It's just faster to create the same thing in a keynote or in a poster. Even before this, we didn't even have a poster that I used in a client engagement. We put it up on the wall, and that's actually where we even iterated on that, because there was a missing column, so we said, let's just draw it on the poster itself. And so those are all like low fidelity ways of testing the concept, and then once you know what you want to build, you then go and build it out.
Yeah, and I think it was also, do people actually want this whole train of thought? It wasn't, we love the idea of running experiments, but were other people that interested in actually putting it to practice and not just saying, hey, yeah, experiments are great.
Can you put this on here? If you look at the kind of the founding of Dropbox, they literally just faked it. Like, they had a video saying what it would do before they even built it.
Well, and the way they got their funding was they got 75,000 signups in 24 hours, and then they got a check, right? There was an obvious amount, and I forgot what the original prediction was. I think they were expecting to have it done in 3 months and ended up taking 18 months. It was a much longer delay.
Yeah, so I think just so we don't rewrite history, I mean, so Drew Houston actually had this build halfway through. It just wasn't launched. So he didn't do like the full lean thing of not building and just doing that. That would be cooler, but he actually was building it.
No product live.
Right,
but
he did this to get into Y Combinator, not even for the test. He just did it because like any application, if you get a few people interested, then it increases the strength of your application. But what happened afterward was this unexpected outcome for him, which was 75,000 people, and eventually over a few days, it was several hundred thousand people interested in the demo. And that changed the whole course of the strategy and what they did after that.
Yep. So does anyone have, we're coming up at 8:15. We're gonna share all of our slides. You've seen the other two decks. I'll share out, I'll talk a little bit about tools that you can use to go putting this to practice. I think what would be good is spending the last 15 minutes diving into someone who felt like you had your goal, you were trying to write a hypothesis, but you want feedback on was this good, was this bad for where I'm at. So who wants to share one? Who has a question on theirs? Yeah.
So
with the top level goal, and then what was it?
My top level goal was to convert people who signed up for something free on my blog into purchasers.
Great.
So, do you want me to read this?
Yeah.
I believe that setting up a drip campaign will boost sales by 5% in a 3-week period.
That's perfect.
But, what do I do?
Huh?
What would you advise me to do?
Go run your good. So here would be the interesting. So we did a lot of drip campaigns, and it's always running. You don't need to go. So how many drip campaign emails are you thinking of doing? Is this like 5, 2? Like, how many would you write now, do you think?
Every week period, maybe like one every day.
Okay, so you would. Okay, so that's a lot of work. So you don't need to write all 7 emails. Whatever that is, 10 and a half emails, you literally need to write the first 2, right? And if you see that, you get 1,000 people to sign up, you get 10% of people to look at email 1, and then you get, of those people, 10% to look at email 2, maybe it's not worth your time doing the rest of them, versus if you see 50% engagement on the first one, 35% engagement on the second one, right? So before you would go off and run and write the whole sequence before launching it, test out the first half of it, and just give yourself enough buffer to stay ahead.
Can I add?
No.
This is a quick question. Have people bought anything from you so far?
Yeah, I've had a few sales here.
Okay, so is there a product that you want to sell at the end of that campaign?
It says course.
It's a course, okay.
They get a free mini course, and then what I'm selling is a bigger course.
It's a bigger one. Yeah, so I would say that, I mean, the 10 emails is just too long. I think only it's free. So there's a guy, Jeff Walker. If you haven't heard of him, you should just go look at it. There's some free videos out there. He has a paid course. If you want, you can buy it, but...
He's got a drip email campaign that you can get into, basically.
it's eat your own dog food. But the idea is that you typically don't need 10 emails. You take the course, and you take the best content of the course, and you give it away. So this is like the idea of, if you give away your best stuff, people wonder how much better like the paid stuff is. It's a marketing trick, but it works quite effectively. It builds a lot of authority. So people always keep the best behind the paywall. You want to give it away. So there's a lot of these techniques that he kind of talks you through, but they actually do, you know, convert well. And so you don't, 10 is also too long, you'll lose people along the way.
Yeah.
You want to have it be very, very concise. And there's a lot of techniques about saying that you're going to launch this course before you actually start that sequence. So you get people primed up, then you put them through it, and it does actually work well. So I would just say check him out, and it's a much shorter way of testing the concept, and it forces you to really get to the core quickly, because people don't have a lot of time to sit through for 30 days to decide what are you really trying to sell me here. Especially if you build trust, and that's why I said if you build trust with your audience, you've sold them stuff before, you want to just get down to parts where you're selling and then parts where you're giving content.
Something like an email has like a known industry average for open rate and click-through rate and stuff like that. So I would think that it behooves you to know what those are first, because if you think like you're going to get a 35% open rate, it's probably not, and I don't know what it is for your average, but that would be beyond the wildest dream for our emails.
Right.
And so I think you need to know what those numbers are so that you're not disappointed if you're getting like a 2% open rate and that's what the average is. Because then otherwise your expectations may be completely unrealistic. Your test succeeded, but you don't know it.
Yeah, I think that brings up a point. So with all this stuff, you want to do a little bit of modeling. So if you have, and you say, I think I'm going to get, you know, 2,000 people to sign up for it, and you do the rest of your conversions. And with that, a lot of times what you want to do is, you don't want to say, I expect this exact number, do a range. Do this is what it looks like if it's high, this is what it looks like if it's low, and that gives you a little bit more buffer in the numbers that you're looking at. It's a really good point.
Okay.
What other hypothesis? I heard a lot of chatter.
So the big one is like, do I offer like free shipping on all orders?
Ah.
So Brandon had a case study about that that's still in the works, but maybe you can talk a little bit about.
Yeah. So we work with a lot of e-commerce retailers, big retailers. One of the ones we're running for Patagonia right now, active clothing wear company, is more about free returns. So similar, they're wondering if they, by offering an incentive, they can cover their cost on what the incentive will cost them internally. So we ran an A/B test to split traffic in order to them right next to the add to cart button. We kind of highlighted the value prop of, hey, if you don't like this, doesn't fit, shipping's on us, send it back, that sort of thing. We're able to measure conversion rate to see the increase in revenue from offering that versus people that didn't see it. And then being able to measure like, hey, how many of those people actually returned it? And did we cover our cost on that? So we saw a really good lift in conversion rate. And I think that's something similar for you, that's perfect A/B test is offering free shipping or not, is being, because I'm assuming your goal is like by offering free shipping, you want people to just buy it more, correct?
Right, yeah, I'm not necessarily gonna lose money unless you're just buying like a very tiny like amount, which is, you know, weird.
But if I understand, like, you haven't sold anything yet.
Not through this site.
Yeah. To me, that's
so not. Yeah.
So that's where we run into like the premature optimization. It's like if you're buying a $4,000 sofa, you give me free shipping. Like, is that gonna make me buy it? Chances are not.
Right.
Like, I mean, they're gonna buy it.
You're testing a little too many things at once there.
Right. And even it's just more like that's an optimization of people. Like, that's a nice to have versus are you really providing a compelling value proposition. So I would much rather see you focus more on conversion to like selling these things. And then the shipping thing is actually, I would put that in like right now a very low priority, the free shipping.
I saw something on the splash page is offering like a 6-month
payment plan once on all orders. So we're just going to break it into like maybe three payments.
Are you able to track how many people put stuff in their cart? Do you have those sort of baselines? Because you could, you know, if you feel that you're losing sales because of your checkout experience, or there's some last minute objection that's arising, that's where stuff like free shipping, or when Brandon comes from Frontgate, right, and if you bought a ticket, like you have 3 minutes to make a decision or that ticket gets released. So I think Ash's point about the conversion is really important. You know, you would want to look at your full funnel as seeing, is it because I'm getting a lot of random traffic and maybe some of those people have no interest at all whatsoever, or is it because people can't ever really find a product that they like? But understanding which one of those metrics and what's the opportunity cost of, if you're going to redesign your product pages, like your product listing pages, and have to go take photographs, and it's a ton of work, versus going off and doing some shopping cart optimizations or doing discounts, maybe one is clear as far as this is what I can do in the short term versus something I start learning more about.
I'm not sure if this is what Ash was trying to get at, but there's an issue of whether this is the forest or the trees. Fundamentally, do you know that you have a value proposition that, and you have a target market that truly values the solution?
Mm-hmm.
So is the reason you're not selling, not because your shipping's too expensive, but because you haven't found the right customers for your solution? So you're getting it?
Or you haven't found a solution, or you haven't found a problem to solve that is compelling to it.
Okay, but the problem is whenever you're ordering cyber furniture, you have to pretty much call in or go into a store. You can't go into a site and customize like a product that has maybe 1,000 different options. So I've got it right now where you can pretty much do that for all my products, and there's really no other site in the country that you can do that. It sells my.
Right, so if you're, free shipping installation is one part, but you are this was to your second one where you wanted like payment plan.
Mm-hmm.
One good check you can do is like if it makes sense, is two furniture stores that exist today, do they actually offer a payment plan? If they're not offering, probably that's not a problem that your customers need to solve. I mean, as a proxy that you can.
A lot of them do, typically.
But I'll just key off something you said earlier, and it does tie into where I was going in with Roger at it, is that I think it's more just narrowing down on who is your target audience. So there's a reason why we don't sell cars wholesale. We don't go into a dealership that sells Lexuses and Toyotas and Teslas and BMWs. It's not, there's a reason for that. And so when the way you describe that you carry every furniture from one price point to the other, that may be a part of the problem, which is that right now you're too broad. And even though you're getting traffic, people aren't either finding what they want or they're not understanding like what you're really about. And you may have to narrow down before you go broad.
You sound more like a platform, not a product provider.
No, but it's only high-end modern outdoor furniture in like Italy and Spain. So I'm not selling, like for example, one brand has about 3,000 products, aesthetically very similar. It's not, when you're getting there, it's not, there's like a wide range of quality.
Well, so one of the good things from like Book Decisive, they talk about running experiments, or you might be benefiting from running an experiment that is radically different. So like focus down on if what everyone sort of here is saying is like, hey, what if you just sold one brand, or what if you just sold one thing? Could you spin off a very quick, could you spin off a sister site, or could you somehow, for a few days, limit what you sell, and just instead of having 3,000 products, having this one product category and seeing if that moves the needle in any way.
Can I just add on? on. If I understand correctly, I misunderstood what your product there was no one have a clear view. You're a premium high-end outdoor, and this probably requires a lot of hand-holding for the customer. So you probably need to, one thing you can probably have is a sign-up page where you can, where you actually have a consultation with the customer, because that's what they do get in an offline store, because they probably, I mean, if I'm spending $4,000-$5,000, I'm probably going to also talk with the interior designer or want to see if it fits the colors, etc., fit in with my, and have a talk there, right? It's not, I'm not buying a bed at the cheapest cost or something at $100 that I can get, or am I shopping for a value? I'm not shopping for a price. I'm looking at the value of Italian furniture, or I mean, you probably compete with Stanley in some ways, right? I mean, Dolphin and all of the brand and stuff.
Yeah, so that can be an assumption.
So you have to look at more of a consultation based here to see if the customers are converting before you actually sell them. I mean, I'm just going off what other high-end furniture stores offline would do.
What they offer.
Consultation.
You're like saying make like the customer experience more enjoyable to the point you get like a sell.
I mean, they probably need a lot more handholding. I mean, expecting them to do a self-serve platform there.
Yeah, that's what Saxon Avenue does. I mean, they have one for their high-end clients. They all get personal assistants.
Have you done any usability tests, or do you have? So one of the things here is, is your phone number? Could I go to your site and see your phone number and call you?
Yeah.
Does that go to you directly?
This goes to my phone.
Yeah. So I think one of the things that could definitely be helpful is trying to, if there was any way for you to talk to your customer and watch them go through your site.
I had live chat installed.
Uh huh.
And that, you know, I got a couple of people going on there that they're just typing by accident.
Yeah, live chat's weird. Like a lot of times it pops up and you're like, I don't want to be bothered by anyone.
Yeah.
I want to share my last one. I want to put sign of not quite sure, usually most very nice. And they offer me, I could actually request for sample levels. Actually, I wasn't having enough, I couldn't decide which color to go for anyway, so I just asked for eight different leather sample, and they sent me that day. So that helped me quite a lot. I even take all the samples to my mom. I asked her to pick the right color for me. And then, you know, you can actually touch the leather and then, you know,
yeah, there's stuff. I mean, maybe it's offering catalogs, right? Maybe it's offering sample sheets out there. I know that's one of the experiments that you guys ran with Blue Dot. But I think the thing you have to look at is if you start framing these at experiments, it starts helping you actually put them side by side. You have probably a mix of, you do probably have some short-term just throughput experiments that you can measure if you have a baseline. But I would really recommend trying to start watching your customers go through your experience to start getting a sense of, well, you know, do you have usability issues or do you have a value prop issue? And being able to distinguish between which one seems to be more important right now.
Yeah, and I like what I was just saying about premature optimization is that you want to, you know, as you're prioritizing your hypotheses and assumptions, it's, you need to test your riskiest parts of it. So the riskiest part is that you haven't found your target consumer. Whether or not you offer free shipping and measure that isn't necessarily going to make a big impact to your business. So like what you were doing here, just talking with them, is like great customer development of going out and interviewing people and seeing like, hey, if you were going to buy, you know, say you're in the market for this furniture, what are the types of things that you would be looking for? And once you start to interview enough people and hear trends on that and hear the same people repeat things, then you're challenging your assumptions in a qualitative way before trying to like increase your conversion rate for maybe a funnel that's too small for your business already.
Yeah, and you could do, I mean, if you want to get like active on it, you could go like Crate and Barrel. You could be outside of it and be like, hey, I'll give you a $25 Amazon gift card if you go take a look at this site, like right here, right? You know, you could, don't think that you can go out, especially in Austin, between Whole Foods and being in Westlake. There's probably somewhere where you can post stuff and get people who would probably shop for your product pretty easily. Or if not, the other thing you do is the first degree network. My wife's an architect, so email your friends, be like, hey, I've got the site, I'm looking for honest feedback on it. You know, do you know anyone who's looking for some high-end products or is looking to make a buying decision? I will help them find their best product, and all you have to do is, I'm just looking to talk to someone for 10, 15 minutes.
Blue Dot has a store. $10,000 couches on Second
Blue
Street.
Blue Dot does have a store.
Yeah.
What the main thing I'm trying to do is I've contacted a lot of the condo buildings downtown, and I want to upload the floor plans for basically every apartment unit type all downtown.
Mm-hmm.
And then I want to, we actually just like convert those into vector drawings,
mm-hmm.
and working with him trying to put together like some sort of web app where he can drag the CAD file from all my furniture that I sell onto your specific floor plan.
Yep, and that's perfect for building a web app on an assumption is risky. That's something you can do by hand. You could print it out. You could actually do the one-to-one concierge service initially to get a sense of, well, is anyone actually really going to even be interested in the service? And you could offer it like you have a web app, and you could say, okay, you know what? We still haven't released our product, but I'd be happy to meet up with you for coffee, and we can design your whole floor plan. What, I know we're running out of time. Questions? Okay. So I will share my email address.
Yeah.
I think Brendan also, if anyone wants more specific, like one-on-one, you want to dive into stuff, feel free to reach out. I always love grabbing coffee with entrepreneurs. So thank you everyone for coming out, and I hope you enjoyed it.
Cool. Thank you.